Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, we have a full house today. And I give you all a warm welcome to this 27th award ceremony of the Olof Palme Prize. A special welcome, as usual, to Lisbeth Palme with family, and of course to our two guests of honor, Gideon Levy and Mitri Raheb. We are happy to see several members of the Swedish government here today, and I think it's indicative of Olof Palme's legacy that they represent the Ministry of Health and Youth, the Minister for Future Issues, and the Ministry for, among other things, local government and democracy. We welcome also representatives of the Diplomatic Corps and the Foreign Ministry, of civil society and churches, from trade unions and Jewish and Palestinian solidarity groups, academia, think tanks, media and publishing houses, cultural workers and artists, the public and private sectors, students and peace activists, leaders of the fair trade movement and of the EU Commission and the UN High Commissioner for Refugees. And what would the world be today without the UN High Commissioner for Refugees? And last but not least, Anders Kompass, Director for Field Operations at the UN High Commission for Human Rights, who earlier today received the Swedish UN Association's distinction, the UN Friend of the Year. Anders worked with Olof Palme in Central America in the 80s and saved many lives there and contributed to the peace processes. And later he went on to work for the United Nations High Commissioner. And his main task there has been to see to it that vulnerable groups like children and women and others have been protected from war and conflict. And for this, he was punished by his superiors for doing his job, but he was then reinstated in full colors, and we honor him also today. Anders, would you please stand up? Thank you. You applaud too much, former Prime Minister Ingvar Carlsson and Ingrid Carlsson, but we recognize you too here. Thank you for always being here with us. We gather here in the old parliament, where also Olof Palme spent much time working as an MP. And in fact, you can see his name over here, indicating somewhere the names of the first MPs here. And also there you can see the name of Lena Hjelm-Wallén, former foreign minister, also present here today. We 2016 will mark the 30th year after the assassination of Olof Palme. Three decades are a long time, but his legacy is intact and still engaging people of all generations worldwide. Olof Palme, radical reformer at home, humble to people without power, and fearless through speakers to oppressing elites, a promoter of peace, dialogue, and disarmament in times of disinformation, propaganda, and militarism. The concept of détente through common security, trade, culture, diplomacy, and people-to-people relations are elements that are missing today in this world of confrontation, xenophobia, occupation, terror, and erosion of human rights and of the right of seeking asylum. It is not a coincidence, not a whim, that at a special commemoration later on next month, the theme will be Olof Palme and the future. It indicates that his personality, his politics, and practical achievements have left an undeniable and inspiring mark. We need people like Palme today. We need them badly. Palme's legacy can be seen in today's politics here in Sweden, when Prime Minister Stefan Löfven, in his first policy declaration in the parliament today said no to NATO membership and yes to Palestine. And we just came with the laureates, with the Palmer Prize awardees from a luncheon with Foreign Minister Margot Wallström, where she reconfirmed that Sweden will continue to try to get more countries to recognize Palestine. And for this, she has been criticized, but we are also very proud of her. As you have seen from the photos on the screen here before, we have had since 1987 the honor of awarding the prizes to men and women from all continents, people who have stood up for human rights with exceptional courage and dedication. Allow me to recognize in our midst Hans Blix, the 2003 recipient of the Olof Palme Prize, for his work against the spread of weapon of mass destruction. He demonstrated under circumstances of strong external pressure, independence, and a commitment to the principle which have inspired respect and admiration throughout the world. Had his work been allowed to be completed that spring of 2003, the world may have been spared the invasion of Iraq and all the horrific consequences we see today in the region and beyond. Walid Sami Abu-Akair received the 2012 Olof Palme Prize for his struggle to promote respect for human and civil rights for both men and women in Saudi Arabia. His relative, Raif Badawi, was sentenced in 2014 to 10 years imprisonment and 1,000 whiplashes for having insulted Islam. We repeat again our demand on the Saudi government: release Walid and Raif and stop the horrific mass executions in your country. In this context, we also remember the 2000 awardee, Brian Stevenson, lawyer and human rights activist in the United States, who has maintained tirelessly that death penalty is an ultimate form of torture and that the state doesn't have the right to kill its citizens. But there is also hope. In Tunisia, Radia Nasraoui, human rights defender lawyer, who was awarded the 2012 Olof Palme Prize for her untiring work against torture and impunity, is now seeing results of her struggle. So does our 2005 awardee, Daw Aung San Suu Kyi, then in confinement in Burma, who became an important symbol of peaceful opposition to repressive power to peoples around the world. Friends, and foes for that matter, it is in this tradition and in the spirit of Olof Palme that we today welcome Mitri Raheb and Gideon Levy among us. The reason for their presence here, for their being laureates, is the following. The 2015 Olof Palme Prize is awarded to the Palestinian pastor Mitri Raheb and the Israeli journalist Gideon Levy for their courageous and indefatigable fight against occupation and violence and for a future Middle East characterized by peaceful coexistence and equality for all. By their work, they both give a ray of hope to a conflict that has plagued and continued to plague millions of people and to endanger world peace. Gideon Levy is working for peace and reconciliation by means of a passionate search for truth and a fearless faith in the victory of reason in a region infested by prejudice and violence, propaganda and disinformation. With parents who were forced to emigrate from Nazi-occupied Czechoslovakia, and as a true patriot, he has made reconciliation with the Palestinian people the mission of his life. A preacher and pastor in the Lutheran Church, Mitri Raheb, in Bethlehem, Mitri Raheb sends a clear message to the young generation of Palestinians. He says, "We want you to live, not to die for Palestine." In a Bethlehem confined on three sides by the walls of the occupying Israeli power, and with Dar al-Qaima University College of Arts and Culture that he founded, and his innovative artistic education in film, art, and drama, Mitri Raheb has made it possible for young people to investigate their Palestinian identity, to nurture beauty, and to invest in a culture of life as tools for a creative resistance against a suffocating confinement and for nation building. Friends, in this connection, it gives me a great pleasure to announce that Antje Jackelén, the Archbishop of Sweden, seems to share our feelings for respect for our awardees. She will meet the Archbishop, Gideon Levy, and Mitri Raheb tomorrow in relation to a dialogue in the Cathedral of Stockholm, which is the church for the whole of Sweden, denominating itself as the Church of Tolerance and Reason. And the theme of their speeches tomorrow there will be, can culture be a way forward to peace? 23 years ago, Olof Palme spoke in that same church, the cathedral. He told us the story of Issam Sartawi, who worked for Yasser Arafat, denouncing violence, and he came up with a plan for peace between Palestinians and Israelis. Sartawi had been killed 3 days before Palme spoke in the cathedral on April 10, 1983. Palme also told a story about Nahum Goldman, founder and longtime president of the World Jewish Congress, who shortly before his death and the Israeli invasion of Lebanon in 1982 demanded the mutual recognition of Israel and the PLO. He argued that there would be no peace for Israel as long as there was not a state for Palestinians. Palme ended his speech by praising the two leaders with a quote from the Sermon on the Mount in the New Testament, "Blessed are those who make peace." Friends, I say, blessed are we to have such awardees today. So are Israel and Palestine, the world at large. Blessed are those who work for peace and reconciliation, tolerance and rule of law. Thank you, Gideon Levy and Mitri Raheb. I have now the pleasure to give the word to Lisbeth Palme.
Ljus.
Det kan vi ordna.
Bra, det var bra. Participants, since 1946, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict has persisted to be on our common political agenda. The complexity of the situation has grown to be incomprehensible. Yet, it continues to break into our hearts and minds. We keep asking ourselves, how would you act if you are of the opinion that this conflict is beyond possibility to take on? Gideon Levy and Mitri Raheb have observed, each from their own perspective, what they could do. They both carry the legacy of grief. They use their knowledge and belief. They are in the midst of the work to give hope. Today we celebrate Gideon Levy and Mitri Raheb with the Olof Palme Prize for their determination to work for peaceful cooperation between people. They appear to have a common dream, also shared by Olof, and he used to articulate it as follows. During the course of life, we all meet the same challenges: to grow up and be educated, to find playmates and friends, to prepare ourselves for different roles in adult life and make our own living, to find somewhere to live and make it into a home, to form a family and bring up children, to keep healthy throughout the life and cope with illness and other misfortunes that may beset us, to secure a decent living and preserve our dignity for the inevitable frailty of old age, to live as free citizens, equal with other members of society, and to take share in being responsible for the common good. Please come and receive your prize.
Thank you. And now we will give the floor to Mithri Rahab first, please. Yes, okay. You're right. It could be a nice gesture, yes.
Dear Lisbeth, thank you for your kind and powerful message this afternoon. Your Excellencies, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, it is truly an honor to be with you on this day receiving the Olof Palme Prize. I have received in the past several prestigious awards, but this one is special to my heart. It is very unique because it carries the name of Olof Palme, one of the most courageous political leaders in the second half of the 20th century, who dared to stand up in the face of empire, a visionary leader who knew that apartheid should not be tolerated, and that the cry for liberation in many countries in the global south should be heard and supported. It is with joy that I receive this prize here in Sweden, a country that has been all along a defender of human rights and international law, a fact that was proven lately by recognizing the state of Palestine, which shows that its government is serious about international law and does not tolerate double standards. Since 2008, the Olof Palme International Center has been a strategic partner supporting us in training future leaders in Palestine and equipping them to become active citizens in the society. This prize is the crowning of this partnership. And I'm glad to share this prize with Gideon Levy, one of the most articulate journalists and a courageous prophetic voice in Israel today. Your Excellencies, next year, Palestine will be commemorating the 100th anniversary of the Balfour Declaration, when the British Empire gave away our land for colonization. The year 2017 marks also the 50th anniversary of the occupation of the West Bank, the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights. I was 5 years old, now you know my age, when I saw the Israeli soldiers marching in the little town of Bethlehem. In all of these years, I was experiencing what the Israeli occupation does to our community. I could see how the whole West Bank started looking more and more like a piece of a Swiss cheese, where Israel gets the cheese and the Palestinians are pushed in the holes. I witnessed this in my own hometown, Bethlehem, where 86% of our land is not under our own control, but being colonized by Israeli settlers who keep exploiting our resources, stones, waters, and minerals. I follow the building of the separation wall, which continues to be constructed as we speak in the Kremzan Valley, not on the Green Line, but in the backyard of the farthest home in town, preventing our city from expansion. As a pastor, I see how this occupation is destroying the fabric of our society. A city that cannot expand is doomed to die. Without possibilities for expansion with new neighborhoods, we cannot do any reasonable city planning. And so the little town, slowly but surely, is losing its character. Without possibilities for expansion and the freedom of movement, unemployment will continue to rise. And as such, we will have more social tensions, more crimes, and with crime come drugs and violence. This is not a natural catastrophe that comes from heaven, but a man-made adversity and a systematically planned one that is subsidized, unfortunately, partly by the international community. As a pastor who lives in the little town, I keep asking myself, how will our people survive physically, socially, economically, and spiritually? How can I preach the good news for people who wake every day just to hear another bad news? The continuing occupation denies us our freedom and the right to exercise our self-determination. It dehumanizes our people. The occupation does not only steal our land, but also our future and that of our children. It robs our kids. And I'm glad that one of my kids, my daughters, is here. It robs our kids from being able to live in dignity and prosperity. The occupation is destroying our souls as Palestinians and the souls of the Israelis, too. But we are not only denied our political and economic right, but also our cultural and religious rights. We are denied the right to have our own narrative that stands on its own. The right to tell our story the way we experience it. The right to read the Bible with our own eyes and not always with an Eurocentric post-Holocaust lens. As you know, a major problem in the Middle East today are those groups who appoint themselves as God judges on earth. They think they have the right to say who is kafir, means in Arabic infidel, and who is not, who is kosher and who is not. In the name of divine rights, they deny us equal human rights. These are not only Islamist groups in Iraq and Syria, or Jewish groups in Israel who have been lately attacking churches and monasteries, but also Christian Zionists, and you have in Sweden some of them, who keep attacking fellow Christians who dare to challenge the Israeli occupation. They want to silence our voices. They want us to believe that the occupation is God's gift to us, and that the land grab that we are experiencing is the fulfillment of God's promises. As a Christian theologian, I have to say that it is not acceptable to violate human rights in the name of divine rights, or to play God against the humans. Groups who do that are misusing the scriptures for their own political ideologies, and they are not much different than ISIS. The scriptures and the Human Rights Charter are there for one and the same reason: to defend the meek, to protect the rights of the weak, to put limits to those in power, and to make sure that the empire adheres to the laws. Both religion and the state have to ensure that the power of law and not the law of power prevails, that the power of culture and not the culture of power has the last word. No religion is entitled to give the Israeli more rights than Palestinians, Muslims more privileges than Christians, or men higher wages than women. Equality is something we cannot compromise on, and therefore we will continue to resist the concept of a religious state. Religious states corrupt both religion and the state, and they discriminate by nature against parts of their own citizens. The state has to treat all of its citizens based on equality. And I think the historic step that Sweden took in the year 2000 in mutual agreement served for a healthier relationship between the church and the state in this country. So we are faced with these immense challenges, and the question has been all along: should we give up? Should we accept our fate? Should we adopt a theology that discriminates against us? Or should we leave and seek asylum away from our homelands, cut from our roots? Or should we escape in a religious fundamentalism clock, comforting ourselves that in heaven things will get better and we'll be much better off? We chose none of the above. We chose to stay. We chose to resist, and to resist creatively. Resist through the word and by constructing our own narrative and developing our own identity. We decided to stay and to commit to keep challenging the occupation until it is dismantled. We decided to stay and to assist in building a Palestinian state that respects human rights, international treaties, and pluralism. We chose to invest in infrastructure by building a brand new university and a cultural and a conference center. We opted to stay and to minister to our Christian community that keeps shrinking day after day. We opted to stay and train the next generation of Palestinian readers who are capable of telling their story through art, film, dance, and theater. Many of the young people in Palestine today have no problem to believe in life after death, but they cannot see life before death that is worth living. So we committed ourselves to creating room for hope, so that our young people will not dream of dying for Palestine, but to live and to serve their community. We wanted them to believe that the sky is the limit and not the wall. We wanted them to become active citizens who are engaged in civil society and do not shy away from assuming responsibility. We committed our lives to keep hope alive, to continue preaching that peace is possible, that Israelis and Palestinians are not doomed to live in conflict for eternity, but to share the land, the resources, and the future. The price we are receiving today is a push to continue this path. Thank you, Sweden, for sticking to international law and human rights. Thank you, Swedish government, for walking the talk and recognizing Palestine. Thank you, Olaf Palme Fund and family, for keeping the course and spirit of Olaf Palme alive. Thank you, family and colleagues, for being such a great big family and such a strong team. Thank you, friends in church and society, for your continuous support and encouragement. Your Excellencies, I'm convinced that occupation has no future. I have no doubt that justice will come. I know that peace is possible. As dark as it may seem, we'll work towards the dream until we see the beam, the light of liberty. And we both, Israeli and Palestinians, will be free, free, free. Thank you for this honor of the Olaf Palme Prize.
Thank you. Give us the address of your church. I now invite Gideon Levy to come to the floor.
So this was hope, and now comes the one who always spoils any party. But I think that for the struggle on justice, we don't need hope. We need to continue. I'm very, very, very excited, moved, and thrilled to stand here today. And this prize has more than one meaning for me. First of all, I will not deny getting prizes is always a pleasant experience. In Israel, nobody would give me prizes, nobody would come and listen to me. And therefore, this prize has a special meaning from a few other aspects. First of all, the timing. You are giving me this prize in times in which in Israel more and more anti-democratic forces are gaining power, in times in which they try to silence us, one after the other, in times of McCarthyism and first signs of fascism, I never used this word before, in the Israeli society and the Israeli regime. Artists, NGOs, are being delegitimized. And in this framework, to get this support is something that has a special meaning for me. And therefore, I'm so grateful, first of all, to the Palme family and to the foundation for coming up in this time when our voice is being silenced in Israel to give us this support. But it has some more meanings for me. First of all, to get a prize on the name of Olaf Palme. I mean, I look at the face of this man, whom I remember from my young years. I did some sins in my life, and one of them was working with Shimon Peres many years ago. I didn't do many sins, but this was one of them. And I remember how Shimon Peres used to criticize Olaf Palme. This is a good compliment for Olaf Palme. And I remember when in Israel they already labeled him as an anti-Semitic and anti-Israeli. And even then I knew that's a great man. Because if he's being attacked in Israel, it's a good reason to trust this man and to believe in his way. And in many ways, he was really a volunteer, a pioneer, someone who stood up in front of the camp, of the EU, of the social international, Socialist International, saying things that then in the 70s and early 80s were totally unbelievable and totally unaccepted. So to get a prize and to stand in a place where he used to stand is, for me, has a special meaning. And finally, to get a prize in Sweden. Maybe their role model today for a state who follows moral values, who follows international law. Many times I think, how dare you, Israel? How dare you, Netanyahu, to blame Sweden for immorality, to blame even Sweden for anti-Semitism, to blame Sweden? Israel has the right to criticize Sweden at all, and to get a prize from Sweden. And I know you face many problems and it's not an ideal place, but still, I wish Israel was Sweden. I wish Israel was a little bit with more values that Sweden is trying to spread all over the world. And this Sweden, you'll be surprised, is giving me already the second prize in my short or long biography. It's a great prize to get today, but the first prize I got 10 years ago. It was one of those days in the Gaza Strip, one of those very depressing days in the Gaza Strip when I went to document some more crimes of the Israeli occupation, and then I came out through the Erez checkpoint, which was then quite a cruel place, and I remember the mood in those days. I remember the screams of hundreds of workers who were coming back from Israel, back to Gaza, being searched and humiliated and going through the regular pass that Palestinians had to pass because they are Palestinians. And then came this pretty Swedish girl to me and asked me if I'm Gidon Levy. And I said yes, and I was really in a bad mood. And she asked me if she can do an interview with me. And I said yes, and I gave her my business card, not really taking it seriously. And ever since then, we live together for 10 years now. Katrin Ormestad, a journalist, a novelist. Her book will appear soon. Please order a copy. Which really stands behind so many articles, ideas, and thinking that I'm trying to spread. And her parents, Suzanne and Joran, who is me here, they opened Sweden for me, they opened their heart for me, and I'm so grateful for this. I was brought up in Tel Aviv, I was born in Tel Aviv. I was really someone that you could call a good boy Tel Aviv. I was a typical product of Israeli education system, of Israeli brainwash system. I was deeply convinced that we the Jews, are the chosen people. And if we are the chosen people, we have the rights to do things that no other people in the world has the right. I was totally convinced that after the Holocaust, the Jews have the right to do whatever they want, as the late unforgettable Golda Meir phrased it once. I was sure that all the Arabs in the world have only one goal, and this is to exterminate the Jews and to send them to the ocean, to throw them to the ocean. I was sure that we are the David, the poor little David, and the Arabs are the huge Goliath who wants to kill all of us. I was sure that you, Europe, you are all anti-Semitics, and you never stopped being anti-Semitics. I was a typical product of Israeli public education system and brainwash system. And it was only in the late 80s when I started to travel to the occupied territories as a journalist. Mitri, you told us that you were, what, 2 months in 67? I was 14. I remember the first tour to the occupied territory as a child. I was part of this national religious orgy then. I went, I saw all those holy places that we liberated. This is what I was told. Bethlehem, we liberated it. Nablus, we liberated it. Hebron, we liberated it. And I remember something very interesting. I didn't see Palestinian there. I saw just stones and history and promises of God and no people. And it was only in the late 80s, 20 years later, when I started to travel to the occupied territories as a journalist, when I realized that the biggest drama of Israel after its establishment is taking place in a very dark backyard. It's taking place far off the consciousness of people, even of their knowledge. And it's only half an hour away from our homes. And it was then in the late 80s when I decided to dedicate my career, my professional career, to try to document the occupation for Israeli readership, to try to tell the Israelis the stories that they don't want to know, and they don't know until this very day. And it was only then when I decided that I am trying to do something which has very, very small chances to succeed. I will try to rehumanize the Palestinians after systematic campaigns to dehumanize them in Israeli public opinion, in Israeli media, and in Israeli education system. And ever since then, I'm doing this quite ungrateful job. Not always it's very pleasant like today. I can't say that 1.5 years ago, when I needed the bodyguards to accompany me, this was a pleasant experience. I can't tell you that for me today to walk in the streets of Tel Aviv is a very pleasant experience, but I'm sure that I'm doing the right thing. And here I am today to tell you, friends, dear friends and distinguished guests, that we need you. We need each one of you. We need Europe. We need the United States, but that's a too far dream. We who try to reach justice, much before peace, by the way. Peace will be the bonus. But first we have to reach justice, some kind of justice, relative justice. But we need you because back home, hope is very little. Israeli public opinion is today by far too brainwashed. Life in Israel is by far too good. And ignorance is by far too deep. Why would Israelis care about the occupation? Why would they care about the Palestinians? We have our own good lives, our vacations, our new jeeps. The media is telling us that the Palestinians are all terrorists. The world is against us, so why would we care about the world? And to expect hope for change from within Israeli society today is, I think, quite an exaggerated expectation. And therefore, we need you so much. We need the world to save Israel from its own hands. We need the world to try to get something very basic, and this is justice. Now, I know many times people tell you that the conflict in the Middle East is a very complex one, and it's not black and white. Let me tell you here, it is black and white. It is not complex. There is an occupier and there is an occupied, very clearly so. Black and white. And as long as it will remain black and white, any man of conscience in the world should identify himself with the just side, with the victim, with the real victim. The Israeli occupation, maybe not the most brutal one in history, maybe not the longest one in the history, but is the only occupation in history in which the occupier presents himself as the victim. Have you ever heard about an occupation who presents himself as the victim? Not only the victim, the only victim. Or again, as the late Golda Meir phrased it in this unbelievable way, we will never forgive the Palestinians for forcing us to kill their children. We are the victims. So in this framework, we need the world to take some measures. We need the world to be a wake-up call for many Israelis who are in coma. We need people like you, states like you, civil societies, NGOs, to remind the Israelis that the crimes of the occupation have an address. They are not a force majeure. They have people who are responsible for them, and they should be taken accountable. And I can tell you here that each of us, every Israeli, carries a responsibility for the occupation. It's not only the settlers, it's not only the army, it's not only the secret services, it's all of us. We are all occupiers. We are all settlers. We are all secret services. Because we let this happen, either by keeping indifferent and silent or by participating in this ongoing crime. By all means, Israel is not an apartheid state. But the regime in the occupied territories is an apartheid regime. It looks like apartheid, it walks like apartheid, it behaves like apartheid, and it is apartheid. When two people share one piece of land, and one people gain all the rights in the world, and the other people get no rights whatsoever, what else is it but apartheid? And here I want to pledge you, don't be balanced. The situation is not balanced. And when the situation is not balanced, nobody can remain balanced. It's not about being balanced. It's about making a new reality, creating a reality in which some justice that the Palestinians deserve for so many years ago will come true. Don't surrender in front of all kind of manipulations, like blaming you as anti-Semitic, like claiming that Israel is in an existential danger, like claiming that it's all about security. Have you ever heard someone mentioning the security of the Palestinian people? Don't they deserve some security? Don't fall to those traps. We met today, Margot Wallström, your foreign minister. Lisbeth, if I may say so, she is maybe a successor of Olof Palme. You have got a courageous foreign minister. Back her. She says the truth, and she should never apologize for saying the truth. She talks from the depths of her heart. She is genuine. She is sincere. And we need voices like her. We need voices who will challenge not only Israel, but also the EU. We need voices who will say the truth. Because after 48 years of occupation, it is about time for the world to stand up and to say, enough is enough. This is unacceptable anymore, any kind of apartheid regime in the 21st century. Yes, there was a Holocaust. Yes, we have guilt feelings. Yes, we carry responsibility, or our parents or grandparents carry responsibility. But exactly because of those responsibilities, exactly because of these guilt feelings, justified or not, we call for justice in the Middle East. And let me dedicate my last sentence to someone that I guess none of you have ever heard. And it would have been so much better if you would have never heard. I want to dedicate my last sentence to Rokia Abu Eid. Rokia Abu Eid was a 13-year-old girl living in a tent in Anata next to Jerusalem. Last Saturday, 6 days ago, she woke up early in the morning, and at 8 o'clock, maybe after a fight with her sister, maybe not, we don't know, she took a knife and went to the settlement, which is 1.5 kilometers from her tent. She was a girl who had nothing in her life. She even didn't go to school after 4 grades. She was milking the sheep. Her father told me she was very good in milking the sheep, but she didn't have much perspectives for her future. Neither her presence was not very good. And she took the knife and goes to the checkpoint next to her home, and she just starts to run with the knife. And she knew that after she's doing this, there's only one possibility, that she will be executed. And this is what happened. Two Israeli armed security, private security people, shot her after 1 minute dead, like they do almost every day in the recent 2 months, claiming that they were in life danger. In the Israeli media, she was defined as a terrorist of 13. People who have children of 13, people who know how children of 13 look like, people who know how girls of 13 look like, people who know how teenagers behave from time to time. Without any doubts, they wrote she was a terrorist of 13, and the security guys had to shoot her dead, not to catch her, not to stop her, not to put tear gas, not to shoot even in her legs, just to shoot her dead, like they did in so many cases in the recent 2 or 3 months. I think today about Rokia. I will continue to write stories like Rokia's story, even if no Israeli wants to hear about Rokia, even if all the Israelis will be deeply convinced that Rokia was a terrorist who deserves death. I will continue. Thank you so much.
And now we will call upon Gustav Schröckli's chamber choir, who will perform graciously, and with great pleasure. We are so happy that you have accepted our invitation, and I give the floor to you now.
Thank you.
Thank you. And welcome back in a short while. In the meantime, ask Peter Hammer again to come up with the two laureates, please, for a short discussion, led by Peter Hammer again, who is one of Europe's most famous and knowledgeable journalists and specialist on the Middle East. Please, Peter.
Dear laureates, distinguished guests, it takes some time, I think, to internalize what you've just said in your very powerful speeches. I actually also remember from this very hall, from this chamber in 1988, when Yasser Arafat was here, together with distinguished Jewish American leaders. And I think it was here that he spoke for the first time about him accepting two states. And this led to the Oslo process, as you may remember, and this led to the glimpses of hopes that we did have in the 90s. And by the Oslo Accords, a Palestinian state was supposed to materialize in 1999, and yet here we are, with all those dark sides that you are describing. And I know, Mitri, that you mentioned somewhere that it's too late now for a two-state solution, given the facts on the ground. But it's too early for a one-state solution. So what shall we do? Both of you.
I think you are better in finding solutions. You have better contacts to go on.
I'm afraid that it's too late for a two-state solution and too early for a one-state solution. And this is why we are stuck in this context in the West Bank, which Gideon described as apartheid. And so how we break out of that, I think this is the question. And for me, this is a process. It will not come, unfortunately, quickly, but it will not come unless we do something about it. And in that sense, I agree with Gideon that actually all of us actually are called to work to get out of this deadlock, because this deadlock of apartheid in the West Bank is not good for the Israeli. And it's not good for the Palestinian. Even if it's on short term, it looks as it's good for the Israeli. So I think we have to think outside the box and to think of new ideas where the two people and the three religions can share the land based on equality. I think this is important. And the other thing is also that each group will have the room to develop their own identity and not feel that their identity is questioned. Within, hopefully, a larger also cooperation. So this would be my hope. But so
let's hear the skeptic now.
Yeah.
No, we share quite the same view. I think that continuing with the old discourse of a two-state solution has only one meaning right now, and this is wasting more time and enabling the Israeli occupation to create new and new realities, build more and more settlements, and maintain the status quo as Israel wished to do all those years. And I think that even those who still speak about the two-state solution, deep in their hearts, understand that this is a train that left already the station. Most of the trains never come back to the station. And with all the respect to this solution, which was a wonderful solution, but Israel did anything possible not to implement it, anything possible to destroy it with the settlement project. This was the aim of the settlement project, and they succeeded, let's face it. And the world enabled it, and the world financed it. And we are facing now a new reality with 600,000 to 700,000 settlers, which no Israeli politician will ever be able to evacuate. And we have to start to ask ourselves, do we stick to this irrelevant solution? I'll be so happy to realize that I'm wrong. I'll be so happy to be convinced that the two-state solution is still
viable. But there is no one in Israel today who really has the slightest intention to go for the two-state solution. And meanwhile, reality changes. And therefore, my idea is that we have to change the discourse. Dear Israel, you won. The settlements are there. The occupation is there. There's only one thing the world can ask from Israel, not ask, but demand from Israel from now on. And this is equal rights. You want to keep the territories, but you can't keep them in terms, in conditions of apartheid. By all means, not. This the world should not accept, like it didn't accept South Africa. And the discourse must be from now on, if I may suggest it, equal rights. What will Israel say about equal rights? That we, the Jews, we are the chosen people, and therefore we have more rights than the Palestinians on the same piece of land? That God promised only us the land and not you? Will any one of you take it seriously today? So that's the goal. It's a long way to go, very long way to go. And this goal will not be achieved only by talks. The world has to do also something. And you know exactly what the world should do. But unfortunately, I don't see signs that the world is recruiting itself. Public opinions, yes. Governments, no. And this leaves me with less hope than Mitri.
And Mitri, you've written extensively about what you call the empire in Palestine, and you've described it as a continuation series of empires from the times of the Assyrians until today, where you describe Israel as a proxy of an empire. Do you also believe then in the one-state solution?
I mean, I wish we can have a one-state solution tomorrow. Because for me, pluralism is something very important. But I don't see it coming soon. But if you would ask me, what would be the solution that, if I were in power, would like to implement? It's a Swiss solution, not the Swiss cheese I spoke about before, okay? But the Swiss model in the sense that you have different groups, different identities, each have room to develop their own identity, to have some kind of autonomy, but within a bigger political framework. I think this is really the best because it ensures equality, and I think here we agree with each other, but also it ensures that groups will not fear that their identity is jeopardized. And thirdly, I think it encourages pluralism because I really am totally against what's happening right now in the whole Middle East, where each group, you know, Sunni have to live alone and Shiite have to live alone and Jews have to live alone and Christians maybe in Lebanon to live alone. I think this is not the future. The future is for pluralism. I would like to see Jewish neighbors living next to me. I would like to see Muslim neighbors living, but on equality, on equal footing. I think this is what I will opt for.
And yet today we have a situation where there's basically no normal contacts between Israeli Jews and Palestinian Arabs. In the 90s, there was actually a people's peace process. The walls are mental between people. So how can you then embrace or foresee that this is going to be possible? Yes.
I just want to complete one sentence about what I said before. I know the Israeli sentiment of having a Jewish state. This was the dream of the Jewish people for 2,000 years, and I'll get to your question. Fine. Anyone who knows what does it mean a Jewish state, I don't. I don't know. Swedish is a Swedish state. I know Sweden is a democracy. I don't know if it's a Swedish state. And Israel should be a democracy. But those who really believe in this idea of a Jewish state, no matter what it means, where have you been until now? I mean, you can't have the cake and eat it. You can't have it both. You want a Jewish state? Pull out from the occupied territories, and then you'll have a Jewish majority. Now, to your question. We have to believe in the unthinkable. And I must tell you that maybe my most inspiring moment was not, unfortunately, not in Nablus and not in Gaza and not in Ramallah. It was in Johannesburg. And when I first came to South Africa, and I know South Africa has so many problems today, but the unthinkable and the undreamable happened in South Africa. Nobody can deny that today South Africa is a more just place than 25 years ago. And things that nobody would have imagined that can happen. I remember when Catherine and I saw the first white beggar in a street corner. And when we saw the first black boss giving orders to his white employee, I told myself there are certain things which look right now unthinkable and might happen. We have to get into it. It's a long way to go. It's breaking many, many thoughts and paradigms. But what is the alternative? The alternative is continuing the status quo. And this should be very clear. This is unacceptable. No more another 50 years of the status quo. By all means, not.
So if we go then to the messages coming out from some of the leaders of the world, we have, for instance, the UN General Secretary Ban Ki-moon, who just expressed that violence is in the human nature against, I think, oppression, what he said. And Netanyahu retorted that this is giving a tailwind to terrorism. We have the US ambassador to Israel, who himself is Jewish, Dan Shapiro, who was lambasting the settler movement and the Israeli vigilantism on the West Bank going unchecked, and who was also talking about two sets of laws for Israelis and Palestinians on the West Bank. And we have Margot Wallström, of course. Now, what does this reflect? Does it mean that we have two outgoing leaders in the UN and in the US, Obama and Ban Ki-moon, who now dare to say what they think? Or does it reflect that the world is sort of getting impatient with the situation? That the criticism comes out more, being more vocal now?
You must direct it to someone.
No, I think you start, because you are more pessimistic on this. I will
First of all, I was deeply impressed by the expression of the American ambassador. He's 5.5 years in Israel. He has all the intelligence in the world, the best intelligence in the world. And all of a sudden, he realized that in the West Bank, there are two sets of laws for Palestinians and Israelis. Surprise, surprise. Where have you been for the last 5.5 years, Mr. Ambassador? Financing exactly this, year after year. On the other hand, why to spoil everything? Better late than never. And therefore, there are new voices in Europe, in the United States even. They are much too late and much too little. You used the word dare. And I want to ask here, why do we use the term dare? What are we afraid of? Who are we afraid from? Why do we have to dare to say the truth? Aren't we living, at least in our countries, in free societies? Why do we have to surrender to all kinds of blackmails and pressures and manipulations? Why can't we just stand for the truth?
And Mitri,
you
want to continue? Okay. Well, you spoke about the problems of fundamentalism in the region, Islamist fundamentalism, Jewish and Christian. And you represent a very tiny minority of the Palestinians who are left now, Palestinian Christians. What is the reason why the Christians of Palestine are leaving the Holy Land?
I mean, we did a study, in fact, in 2008, and we asked this exact question. And the overwhelming majority of people said, I think 45%, they said, because of the occupation. I think around 40% or so said it's because the economical factor. I mean, they cannot move freely, they cannot trade freely, they cannot, they keep building their businesses and then the war comes and then they have to start all over again. I mean, imagine, I'm 53 years old, right, my wife? I think 53, right? And I have witnessed 10 wars already. 10 wars, which means, you know, we started every 7 years a war, then every 5 years a war, then every 2 years, and now every year we have a war. And imagine, how can you do business in such a situation? And so this is really, and only a very tiny minority, I think 1.something% said of religious extremism. But in the last few years, especially if you go to Jerusalem, you feel that more and more in Jerusalem and around Al-Aqsa Mosque, where Jewish settlers are trying every day to go there, and Muslims feel, you know, they have to defend their sanctuary, the conflict is becoming more and more some religious connotation, which I think is very, very dangerous. Because this is not a religious conflict. As I said, we are not doomed for eternity to live as enemies. This is a political conflict, and it means we can solve it. It is solvable. And so I'm concerned about religious fundamentalism. I'm concerned about Christian Zionism. I talked about that, which I think sometimes we forget about it. So we need to keep, underlining that this is not a religious conflict, but a political conflict. This is really important.
Gideon, to you, you've been active as a journalist for 30 years, and you really devoted your career
I'm
to...
I'm not 30 years old. How can I be 30 years
old? Oh, you devoted your career to describe life under occupation. But if you see that what's happening now in Israel and the mindset, does journalism help?
It depends what kind of journalism. I think that the Israeli media in general, with some exception, maybe with one exception, and this is my newspaper, Haaretz, the Israeli media is playing a destructive role. Not, by the way, because of ideology, but mainly because of commercial reasons. Not because of any governmental censorship, but because of something which is much worse than governmental censorship, and this is self-censorship. I think the Israeli media is the biggest collaborator with the occupation as a whole. I think the main damage is in this ongoing campaign of dehumanizing the Palestinians, which enable us Israelis to feel so good about ourselves. Because if they are not exactly human beings like us, so there is not really a problem of human rights. And this dehumanization, which is taking place systematically, it's not one time or one story, but if you see the coverage of the Palestinians in Israeli media, it will always be either demonizing them or dehumanizing them. And by the end of the day, the Israeli media is telling the Israelis a story which helps the Israeli society to live in denial, as it does, which helps to spread the lies, many lies, and which helps to so many Israelis to feel so good about themselves while all those crimes are taking place half an hour away from their homes. Try to tell an Israeli that the IDF, the Israeli army, is the second moral army in the world. Not the first, but the second moral army. Let's say the army of Luxembourg is the most moral army and the IDF is the second one. They will be deeply offended. How can you dare to say so? It is the most moral army in the world. The Israeli media helps them to believe in this lie.
But the prevalent narrative in Israel is that there is no partner on the Palestinian side, and they can also pinpoint corruption, cronyism on the Palestinian Authority. And of course, the violence, the stabbings, the rockets from Gaza, and the remembrance of the suicide bombers of Hamas in the 90s. So what about the partner?
Let me be quite tough with you. For making justice, you don't need a partner. When I steal your car,
I can't put conditions for returning the car. I mean, I have first of all to return the car, and then we'll speak if there is partner, if what are the conditions, what will be the relations. I believe there is a Palestinian partner, and for sure there was a Palestinian partner, and Israel did anything possible to miss the opportunities one after the other. Arafat was too strong, Abu Mazen was too weak, Hamas, you don't expect us to do peace with those fundamentalists. But by the end of the day, it's not about partner, it's about justice. And you are not, Israel is not in a position to put conditions, with all the respect.
So to wrap up, Mitri, you have been talking about the need of what you call a creative resistance, not only non-violent methods, but creative resistance. And you're also calling for what you say, boycott, divestment, and sanctions, and against occupation policies. And these can be applied in different ways. You could say that the EU labeling of products from the settlements is a way of having milder sanctions. And you can have the wider sanctions also addressing or affecting Israeli academics and cultural life. So which do you prefer, the wider or the milder? Which is the more efficient, and then leading to justice?
I think, you know, sometimes people are in different stages of their life. And for some, maybe at the beginning, they start with the milder. But I think at the end of the day, it's about this. Do anyone want to benefit and to earn money on the expense of the Palestinian? This is the question. And can these people sleep that night if they know actually some of their incomes come from oppressing the Palestinians? And, you know, for some people, they think this is wild, or as you call it, wider, but it's not. And let me give you one example. You know, when Martin Luther King called for the blacks to boycott, you know, in Montgomery, the buses, mm-hmm. 8 bishops wrote him a letter saying, why are you so becoming so radical? But you know, without that step, even today, we will be talking about dialogue between black and white in America. And they have to love each other, and we have to reconcile them. But at some point, you have to be radical because, you know, if you don't become that, you know, if you don't take that step, it might be too late, and there will be more casualties, there will be more people. So I would say, you know, it's important for all of us, not only on Palestine. I mean, I remember when I studied in Germany, you know, I started not buying things that hurt the environment. I mean, and this is, I think, for you in Sweden important, as responsible citizens in the society, we have always to make decisions what to buy and what not to buy. This has nothing to do with Israel. This has to be of becoming, you know, responsible and active citizens in the society. You have always to make choices, and one of these choices is BDS.
Dear laureates, time is running very fast when we speak to you, and we have plenty of more questions, but there will be more time in the church tomorrow, and I would like to give you a big hand. Thank you.
And now we invite back the choir, please.
Menschen wie uns Studenten zurückliegen haben. Jetzt das Logo kennen, wo Dingen Storm über uns sinden. So leben denn die Wora minden. Vor Trämmung Sommer lobet du kjære venn, jeg minns deg som en glad kamrat og ville gjerne se deg igjen. O klang og jubeltid, jeg vet jo at du fanns. Jeg slutar ikke hoppas, kanskje ses vi åter noen gang. Du kanske bara var en känsla och aldrig krass realitet. En sån kan likväl vara sanning för den som inget annat vet. Du nalkas ljuva som som tror och som ännu bär på framtidsdrömmar. Det är en kraft som genomströmmar vår existens, vår sanna verklighet. Och vår jubeltid, var finns du kär?
Gustav Sjöqvist Kanacke, tack. I will let you in on a secret. When I met Katrin and Gideon two nights ago, he revealed a secret passion. I talked about the Museum of Modern Art or things like that. Maybe he would like to see that, his free time. He wanted to go to the ABBA Museum. Katrin and I, we made up a compromise, a wonderful compromise. From the Benny and Björn songbook, we got you people, Christina Dunebola, and thank you for your wonderful music. We needed to be lifted up. Thank you. And thank you all for coming here and making this afternoon a wonderful event, inspiring event. And I think you, both of you, gave us an idea of creating a new popular movement. What should we do with all this pain, all this suffering? And I think you came up with an idea about peaceful, creative, constructive resistance, summed up in two words: fair trade and equal rights. That wouldn't be difficult to mobilize people around. Fair trade and equal rights for Palestine and in the whole region. Thank you. And now you're all invited to a drink and, above all, a mingle party, friendly mingle party. No fists allowed, just hugs. Thank you.